Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Showing Up to Your Life podcast YouTube channel. My name is still Art Burns, and I am really excited today. I'm even a little extra special excited today because a couple of things this morning happened that are really, really amazing. And you know, it concerns anger because, as you know, it's all anger all the time these last couple of weeks until I do this webinar on Sunday, okay? I promise the end is near, okay? We're going to get back into the beautiful stuff again very soon. Actually, tomorrow's episode is going to be really kind of nice and sweet and beautiful like we always have been. but today is also actually, you know, this actually gets back into the sort of basics and the sort of, you know, very foundational aspects of mindfulness, right? Because two things happened this morning that had they happened, you know, a few years ago when I was completely wrapped up in my anger, you know, I never would have noticed them. And that's the thing, right? And so one of the things that happened this morning was, you know, the second thing, actually. I was on a call with one of my clients this morning, or one of my partners, as I like to call him. Is that word still, there's something still not quite right about it, but it's just, I don't know what to, my brother, my dude, whatever, you know, but another one of the people who I love and feel very fortunate and grateful to be able to work with every week. I was in a call with him this morning, and you know, he said something during our call that just really, you know, just stood out. And like, you know, I mean, we said quite a lot of things, you know, during our call, that all of them were pretty amazing stuff. But the one thing that really stood out, and this really complemented something else that had happened earlier, about an hour, half hour earlier this morning, from this statement that my friend and my partner and my client said, is that, you know, what he said was, you know, I can't even remember the old me. Right. And that's something that has been so powerful for me. Like, in that, you know, not just this morning, not just in these last few weeks as I do this, you know, get into the anger. Sorry, turning off the heater here, getting into the anger webinar and stuff, you know, beyond that, it's something that's been alive for me for a couple of years now, for quite a few years now, actually, that I don't remember what I used to feel like. And that is just staggering to me because back then I never thought I could feel any other way. Right. And so what I'm talking about is, and this actually, so in addition to this, the other thing that happened, let me tell you this first before I get into the whole, you know, everything we're talking about here. But the other thing that happened this morning was I, you know, yes, like everybody, you know, I check my messages first thing in the morning. You know, it's something I don't do it first thing. Okay, I meditate first. That is always true. Okay, I never touch my phone before I do my meditation, and that's going to be one of the rules of our new anger program here, right? The anger transform program is going to ask and maybe even demand that you do not do that, that you do not look at your phone until you have gone through a morning routine, right? Now, a lot of people will tell you for the first hour, don't touch your phone. You know, I'm not going to go quite that drastic on it, but I am going to make sure that you do a couple of things before you look at your phone. It's going to help a lot. Okay. So, but when I did open my phone this morning, right, I saw that I had a message, an email from someone who, it was a marketing email. Right now, I sign up for a lot of marketing emails because I'm fascinated by it, right? I'm fascinated to see how, you know, how people communicate, how people sort of pitch their stuff. And I love the email, you know, sales pitches. I don't know. There's something about it that's really, I mean, I never buy anything from them, so I don't know if it's a good thing or not, but I really enjoy the sort of, the whole aspect of how this sort of thing happens. And I just really, it's fascinating to me. Right. And I also, it's fascinating as a professional interest, right? Because I am now getting into using some of this stuff and I've wanted to use it for a long time. As you know, I send emails out every morning, but they're not really sales emails, right? That's not what I'm doing, right? And I'm not going to stop sending the emails I am sending and start sending sales emails, but I'm just really curious and really kind of trying to, you know, maybe mix it into what I'm doing a little bit. It's probably the best way to look at it. But this morning, just now, I just did my first Facebook ad, and I'm like, I don't even know what to do. I have a Google ad running right now. I have a Facebook ad running right now. And it's really exciting, you know, although they're not performing as well as I was hoping that they would have. And I'm watching the money, you know, kind of add up here. And so I'm hoping, you know, as long as I get a couple of, you know, return on it, you know, a couple of people sign up, it'll return for me. But anyway, that's a topic for a different story. But pardon me for digressing again. This morning I opened this email, right? And this email was written in a really fascinating way, in a really beautiful way. The person who was marketing, and it was I don't even remember, something for lawyers or psychotherapists or something like that. Just, I'm on all these different lists. But the way that this person had written the email was that she, and it was a woman, she wrote the email as a future-based thing, right? So, and what I mean by that was that she said, imagine this, right? And yeah, it was for a therapist who this woman helps to get therapists to charge more money for their work, right? And so you know, her email was something along the lines of, okay, picture this, it's January 2022, you're walking into your waiting room and there's all these people in there that are booked and they're paid, you know, that kind of thing, right? Like, she just kind of, you know, just did this, like, sort of drew this picture, right? Well, when I was on the phone with my buddy, my friend, my client, my partner this morning, and he mentioned that aspect of, like, I can't even remember what the old me was like. It all just came together. The woman's email and what he said and what I've lived for the last, you know, few years, it all just crashed together in this beautiful explosion of inspiration. And it made me, you know, remember that, you know, that when we're going through, and especially when it's anger, right? Anger more than anything else, right? Anger is going to do this to you, right? Where it changes the whole perspective, right? And it kind of puts you in a place where you literally don't feel like you can, like, there's any other way to feel. And that you'll never feel any other. Now, anger is not the only thing that does this. I know I said that anger more than anything else, but it's not the only thing that does this. In fact, you know, my client this morning was struggling with a cold. And this is something that happens when we have a cold, right? Like when you get a cold and you feel like, and this is something else that we said during the call, is like, you feel like, I don't even know what it feels like to not have a cold, right? Like, I don't even know what my body's supposed to feel like right now. You know, like what does it even feel like to be healthy, right? And that's not to say healthy is in terms of, like, in shape but just to not have a cold, right? Like you get so in it that it's like, I don't know what it's like to be out of it. You know, like, I've forgotten. Right. And of course, with a cold, that happens like in a matter of days. Right. But with anger, it's a slow burn. Right. It's a slower process that drags out over years and years and decades even. Right. And as it does, it really damages us. You know, it damages us to the point where we lose our bearing. You know, we lose the bearing of who we used to be before we were, you know, before we were overwhelmed with all this anger, right? And again, it's like, and this is such a, you know, and again, this is a common thing for mindfulness even, right? That you know, the weird thing that happens as you do this work, you know, I always thought, like, when I was starting the work, right, I thought that somehow there would be a moment where I felt different, you know, like something changed, right? Like, whether it happened like in the middle of the day, like, whoa, what was that, right? Or it happened like waking up one morning, it's like, whoa, something's different about me. What is it? This is amazing, right? I always thought that it would be like that. It's not like that. It's not like that at all. But in fact, in some ways, it's much more powerful than that, right? Because what happens is you don't feel different in your body necessarily. I mean, of course you do, you know, because in fact, what you're doing in mindfulness is you're feeling everything a lot more than you ever used to feel it before, right? So you do feel some difference for sure, right? But it's like the... you don't notice it because you're in it, right? But what you do notice, okay, and what you can recognize is the difference with which you respond to things, the difference with which you speak, and like, you know, the words you choose to use, the tone you choose to use, that you choose to use with those words, right? The reactivity that you no longer engage in or become victim to, right? Those are the things that you notice are changing, right? And so why this is such a kind of aspect of mindfulness, right? And this is going back to the basics here, you know, taking a little step out of the anger, going right back to the basics of mindfulness, is that, again, if I were not practicing every day to be more mindful, to be more aware and attentive of what is happening as it's happening and doing so without judgment, if I wasn't doing this work, I might not have noticed the email. And the comment that my client mentioned, it might have just passed. It might have just been, oh yeah, that's true. I felt that too. That's great. Let's move on, right? But the thing is, like, when you give yourself some time to slow down a little bit, right? And it doesn't mean to become less effective. In fact, getting slower means more efficacy, right? And you gotta, give me a chance to show that to you. Give me a chance to prove it to you, and I will, okay? It'll take some time, but I will prove it. But when we slow down a little bit and we allow ourselves to be here, right? Like right here, right now, not 3 o'clock in the afternoon when I have this meeting with this person, not, you know, the email that I have to send, not the drive I have to make, not the store I got to go to, not this, not that, but no, being right here with what's happening right now. I'm reading this email right now, right? And so what happens is when you do this, right? When you come into this present moment, right? All the time, like 100%, right? Now, of course, it takes a long time to get to that point, right? And I'm not even at that point. Like, there are moments where I find myself, whoa, I just got like all wrapped up in this. But the difference is that you notice it. That doesn't take that much time. That's a matter of weeks, right? Well, you'll be able to notice it and come back to it, right? But when you're practicing this and when you're really practicing being 100% present, right? You are taking everything in a more full and more sort of vibrant and more impactful way, right? And that's why things like memory improve. I mean, memory also improves because you're reducing stress, right? Stress response, you know, the stress response of your body actually inhibits the brain's ability to remember things, right? But you're also not remembering things because you're not really registering them. Right? Like you're seeing something, but it's sharing space in your head with, you know, with the meeting or the email or the store or the whatever, right? It's, you know, you don't have an exclusivity, right, to your experiences. And that exclusivity, right, that being able to really just pay attention to this, right, what it does is it registers more deeply. And you become more of, you know, you become more a better memory person. You know, you become better at remembering things. I forgot how to talk for a second. So that's what came up for me this morning, and it was amazing, right? Because, you know, and anger does this, right? Anger will, oh, we're coming back to the anger now. I knew we could do it. I'm very proud of us. Oh boy, excuse me. I have this wobbly IKEA desk that I use, and something just got knocked over. Pardon me for that noise. But it is very much the powerful emotions of things like anger or, you know, shame can do this, grief can do this, you know, that these emotions, right? You know, again, I talk about how specifically with anger, right, it changes our perceptions, right? It changes the way we look at things. There's a great story I can tell you about this, okay? Classic story of I think it's an old Chinese story, right? Where a man comes home to his house and he notices that his bicycle is not on the porch where he always keeps it, right? And in that moment, he's feeling like, holy crap, somebody stole my bicycle and I've been victimized. He's feeling wounded. He's feeling very angry in defense, right? That's what we do, right? The minute, and that's how anger works. And that's what anger is supposed to do for us, right? It's supposed to help to motivate us in times when we need it, right? And so he sees that his bike is gone and he begins to feel angry. He's, how could somebody have taken my bicycle? I have to prime myself to figure out how to get my bicycle back, right? And at that moment, he sees the neighbor boy walking by. His kid's like maybe 12 years old, and he sees that boy and he looks at him. He says, ooh, that boy looks like a thief. He looks as guilty as he could possibly be. I'm sure that's the boy who stole my bicycle. Now I have to find a way to go and get that bicycle back from him. And so he's walking around his house trying to figure out how he's going to do all this. And he's ruminating and he's steaming and he's wringing his hands and he's pacing back and forth in his house. And he goes to the back door of his home and he opens the door. He says, you know what? I need some air. I gotta try to, you know, just ground myself. So let me go outside into the grass in the backyard with my bare feet and just see if I can calm myself down a little bit. Right. And so he walks outside into the backyard and he looks to his right and there is his bicycle. And all of a sudden he remembered, and all of a sudden all the anger just disappeared. And he remembered that he brought his bicycle into the backyard so that he could clean it yesterday. And that's why it wasn't sitting in the front yard and it was in the backyard safe and sound as it always has been. He had this great sigh of relief and he even giggled a little bit. And oh my gosh, how crazy was that? I almost went and, you know, stormed into my neighbor's, you know, house and told them that their son, you know, stole my bicycle. How horrible that would have been. And oh my gosh, I'm so glad that didn't happen. Whew. So he shakes himself off and then he walks his bike out to the front and puts it back on the front porch where it belongs. And at that moment, as he's about to walk back into his home, he looks and the neighbor boy is walking back home from wherever he was in this last hour or whatever. And this boy just looks so sweet and so kind. And this innocent little 12-year-old boy who just wouldn't even know how to hurt somebody if he tried. And he said to himself, gosh, that's such a nice kid. I'm so grateful to live so close to such a nice kid. So you see what happened there? Right. So when we're experiencing anger, right, like that's what happens when we're in that place of anger, the person who represents something to us, right, they're going to seem a certain way, right? Like, so let me phrase that differently. You know, I mean, I think the story speaks for itself. I'm sure you get it, right? But the idea is that, you know, anger makes us see things that aren't really there, or they make us see things in a way that is simply not true. Now, of course, this also is a foundational aspect of mindfulness, right? You've heard me talk about delusion, clinging, and aversion forever, right? Like that may have been the very first episode I ever recorded on this podcast talked about those things because they are so integral to the whole process of mindfulness, right? And the idea of delusion is that we're often not seeing things for what they really are, right? And that's something that happens to all of us, right? It's a key core concept of mindfulness for 2,500 years because it's such a universal struggle for so many people. Right. And so the idea then is so all emotions will do that to you. Right. It's not, and of course, if it's something that's 2,500 years old and so, you know, so prominent and globally, appreciated. Right. It can't be confined just to anger, right? It's all of our emotions do this to us, right? All of our emotions make us see things the way that we believe them to be true, right? We've talked about how we experience everything we experience within our own nervous system, right? You know, the boy is not just a boy, right? The boy is how you believe that boy to be, right? And so all emotions are going to do that, right? As well as, you know, various, you know, traumas of our past will also do that, right? But when emotions are doing that, right, what we can say is anger is by far the most powerful emotion that we can experience, right? I mean, anger and then rage. Those are the number one and 1A, right? Like that's the height of our emotional experience, right? The emotional spectrum, right? Now we can feel other emotions in as powerful kind of ways, right? Like grief, we can feel that level. And that's the only one that sometimes happens that way, right? Most of the other emotions don't really get to that point, right? Because that's the thing about anger, right? Is anger is there literally to save your life, you know? So it's always going to be a very powerful emotion, right? So if all the emotions kind of create this delusion, well, then anger creates the delusion on a much bigger scale, a much more powerful level, right? And so the reason I talk about this, right, is that, you know, right now you might feel like there's no other way to live, right? I felt that way for decades of my life. I felt that, you know what? It is what it is. This is just the way my life is. And this goes back to that, you know, we did an episode a few weeks ago about Carl Jung, right? Where we talked about the shadow, right? And Carl Jung has this great quote that I don't remember, so I'm not going to give it. But basically, he says that when the shadow remains unintegrated or disintegrated, right? It rules our life in a certain level, right? And we call it fate. Right. And that's the thing, right? That your anger can be that thing, right? And you might feel that it's your fate to be angry. You might feel that it's your fate to just always feel this way, to always just be annoyed by the things that people do. To one of the other things my client said this morning, he says it used to feel like the whole world had a meeting the night before about how they were going to screw up my day, right? Like, you know, like that's the level that we get to, right? And so you might feel as though there's no other alternatives, right? And that's why I tell you that I can't even remember how I used to feel that way. And believe me, what you're feeling now, if you're feeling what I'm describing, what you're feeling now, you can multiply it probably by 10 to feel what I was feeling back then. I mean, truly, oh my gosh, I have so many different stories. I don't want to take too much time here. We're almost at the end of this this video. But suffice it to say, and I'm not trying to diminish what you're going through. I mean, it's very possible that you're feeling exactly what I used to feel. And I'm not, nobody wins or loses in this, okay? But I'm just letting you know that if anything, you know, you can believe that I felt it. And I felt it strongly, and I felt it really hard. And I felt exactly the way I described it before, as though there's just literally no other way. Like, it's just, like, this is it. You know, this is life. Maybe in my next life, I'll not be so angry. Like, that's literally how I felt. But now, I can't even remember how that all felt. I can't even remember what life was like back then. I remember a few details. I can remember a few incidents where my anger boiled over and I had a confrontation with somebody. Of course, I remember those big events, right? But I can't remember like what it felt like to look at myself in the mirror, right? Like I can't remember the difference, right? But what I can tell you is that I don't feel any of that now. Right? Not even a little bit. There's never a point where I feel that the world is conspiring to get me. There's never a point where I feel that I'm about to lose my control, right? And lose my temper. It just doesn't happen anymore. I get angry. I feel anger. I experience anger. Of course I do. Pretty frequently, actually. And that's something else that, you know, because of all the practice I had, you know, my anger is kind of, you know, it's a skilled anger, you know, and I'm really good at getting there. And so that might be, you know, as I told my client this morning, I'm talking a lot about this meeting this morning, but, you know, one of the things that came up is that it's kind of like alcoholism that way. Right? Like I'm never not going to be susceptible to overdoing the anger. That's always going to be with me, but it doesn't have to be a liability and it doesn't have to be a problem. In fact, now when I experience anger, anger, you know, arises within my happiness, right? It's integrated within my happiness and my compassion and my caring and my motivation for doing good things, right? Anger exists within that now. It does not take it over. It does not shove it out of the way. It is, I coexist with my anger now. And I want to teach you how to coexist with your anger too, because that's the key, right? That is the key. And I'm going to tell you a lot about that in just 3 days from now on Sunday night, May 16th at 6 p.m. Mountain Time, which is 5 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern. I am going to spend about an hour or so walking through a couple of really deep and powerful stories about my own anger, a couple of really amazing stories about how I overcame my anger. And I'm going to, most importantly, the bulk of it is going to be talking about practices and concepts and philosophies and techniques and tips to help you to get from where you might be right now to where I am right now, which I'm telling you is just a lot more comfortable. It's a lot more fulfilling. It's a lot more in touch and connected to my life. I'm showing up to my life, and I want you to show up to your life too, without the anger, right? Or with anger in its proper position, all right? So check out the webinar, y'all. The link will be in the description, and also in the description will be a link to book a free phone call with me if you would like to. Okay, we can talk about all kinds of stuff, whatever's on your mind. Certainly we can talk about the upcoming course or the webinar, or we can talk about anything else that's on your mind. All right. All right, everybody. Thanks a lot for listening. I'll be back again tomorrow to talk about a really beautiful concept, and I can't wait to share it with you. All right, everybody. Take care. Have a great day.